Yeah, well, the piano's.
Seven o'clock, we'll call the meeting to order.
We don't know.
First item of the agenda is the acceptance of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Walk-in, anyone here for the walk-in period? No. Meet the applicant for public buildings, Mr. Campagna. How are you? Would you come up if you would, sir? Thank you for applying. And if you would just give us a brief history, not a history, but a...
My name is Carl Campagna. I'm a resident of Scituate. I've been a resident for quite a few years now. And I was on the original building committee many years ago, and because of job responsibilities and family responsibilities, I had to phase out of the committee. But I heard that there was an opening, and I am now semi-retired. I'm still doing work for the company that I retired from, and I think I'd be interested in reapplying for the committee. I feel that I would be a viable candidate in that, because of my background and some of the responsibilities that I had in my position, working with budgets, job progress, and I worked on multi-million dollar projects for the company that I was with.
Great, thank you. To the board, any comments, questions?
I've just known Mr. Campagna for many years, and I think he'd be an asset to the Public Buildings Commission. That'd be great.
Yep.
Thank you very much for volunteering.
The only thing I'd add is, we've read the backup, but you're an architect.
Yes.
So you have...
I am a registered architect,
Yes. So you have that expertise in terms of structural design and all that sort of stuff.
Exactly,
yes. Very helpful to the committee, so I think you'd be a great asset, so...
We'll be making the appointment later on this evening.
Okay.
No need for you to stay around.
Unless you want to.
Unless you want to. And if you want to, that might shed some doubt on you. No need to stay around. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you for your interest.
Thank you.
Thank you for your interest.
Board of Assessors set the residential tax rate. This is an annual agenda item prescribed by law. Welcome, gentlemen.
How you doing?
Hey, Fred.
How's it going?
Nice to see you.
I haven't seen you in a while.
Steve?
Steve, come on up.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Steve?
Hi.
Must be talking to you.
Why don't you introduce yourself? We'll go around the table.
Steve Gard, 51 Garrison Drive, Board of Assessors.
Fred Avila, 4 Brook Street, Chairman of the Board of Assessors.
Steve Jaswambowski, Director of Assessing.
Todd Glowak, 75 Turn Road.
Steve, go ahead, or whoever's going to make the presentation.
Once again, the board looked over the information that we had with commercial property versus residential property, and we've decided to maintain the same rate on both commercial and residential property. It just doesn't fit in this town. We just don't have enough commercial property.
And that's pretty much the same as it's been for long time.
Long before even you and I, Jeff.
I doubt it, but yeah, I think you're right.
Since classification existed, 1978 or whatever, when there's the option of having a split rate, we've never had a split rate.
Yeah, there's just not enough.
The town has never had one.
No.
No.
Any comments from the board?
No. Just maybe we could just run through some of the numbers real quick, Steve, sure. If you want to just show
sure.
people.
Sure.
on your spreadsheet here, you want me to do it or you want to... just what the tax rate's actually going to be?
Yeah, there's a slight adjustment to that. That was a projected number of 1275 per thousand.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at 1272 per thousand, an increase from 1234. The average tax bill would be 6056 as opposed to 6070 that's on that sheet. Commercial tax bill would be slightly small, a lot lower. I didn't do the calculation for that, but 9321 would be about 9,200 and some odd dollars.
So the average commercial real estate is $731,000.
That's the same.
So it's considerably higher than
it is, yes.
The residential.
Yeah.
And on the spreadsheet here, you get the 10% shift and the 5% shift.
Right, those are just two examples. You can shift as much as 50, but...
In terms of what the average...
Exactly.
...household is.
And the impact, as you see, doesn't make a big difference. I mean, the residential taxpayer would realize a $19 difference in their tax bill decrease, while the commercial would increase $461 at a 5%.
And what is the shift, actually? If the...
That's shifting the levy from residential to commercial.
Okay.
You'd shift 5% of the levy total.
Oh, I see.
Residential class to the commercial class.
Okay.
And they would pick up all that levy.
Right.
We only have 140 parcels or so that would pick up that additional levy.
So if you shifted at 5%, it's only going to change the average person's bill by about $19.
Exactly.
Correct.
But significantly, though, if I may interject, is that a 10% adjustment will save the residential person $38, but then it'll burden our commercial guy $929 a year.
Right.
It's a really significant difference between the two. So when you move 10% of the levy off to the small amount of commercial property that we have, the burden becomes quite significant.
Particularly when the Economic Development Committee is trying to get businesses in town, and
exactly,
you know, it's kind of counterproductive.
We just don't have the commercial base. I mean, we, you know, 4.5% of our property is commercial. That's it.
Right. So that's an important number, 95% to 5%.
Definitely is.
Did you say there were 140 parcels of commercial?
Give or take, yeah.
About that, yeah.
You think about the commercial property that we have. It's mom and pop stuff. It's not Target. You know, we're not burdening some giant conglomerate publicly traded. We're going to burden people who live in town that are trying to make a living. So the board strongly believes that this is the most effective tax rate that's fairest across the board for everyone involved.
A motion?
And I think a motion, please.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to classify all the property in the town of Scituate at 1.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That is unanimous.
Thank you all.
Thank you for coming in.
Guys, have a good Thanksgiving.
Thank you, Frank.
Next, a discussion and a vote on the entertainment license for Reavers. How are you?
How are you?
Good. All yours.
I'm Michael Tondorf. This is Kara Tondorf, owners of Reaver Restaurant, and we're here to apply for the entertainment license.
And for indoor?
Yes. We're looking to do just some acoustic music. No bands, nothing like that. Just light acoustic music. Nothing after probably 9 or 10 o'clock at night. You know, we're thinking Sunday afternoon type of thing, but we'd like the permit to be, you know, not strictly limited to that. But again, just lightly amplified acoustic music. Songwriters, stuff of that nature.
Moth on your arm.
Lightly amplified. Explain lightly amplified. That's the only question I have.
For example, there's a Bose system that's like a little tower, and that's the speaker, and you plug into that, and it just gives you a little bit more boost than simply someone just using the acoustics of the room itself. Again, nothing overpowering. Just, I'm a songwriter. I've done that for many, many years, and I think it would be a nice thing to bring into town. Sunday afternoon type of thing, maybe a occasional songwriter for a dinner show.
What part of the restaurant are you thinking about doing it in?
Probably the main dining room, but maybe in the bar for like an afternoon. Again,
it's just limited space, obviously. You
right,
know.
Yeah, ideally it'd be one individual playing an acoustic guitar while people had brunch, and it's, you know, we're not looking to take down the house. We don't have any room for it.
Right.
You know, it'd be just a band and no patrons.
And furthermore, we're not looking to do something like to bring the late night crowd in longer. That's not our intention by any means. It's more just something new to do in Scituate. Go see a songwriter.
Do you intend to use the patio as an option?
Not at this time.
Okay. I only say that because I caution you. It's better to kind of do it slowly and build up as opposed to start out. And then kind of some of the neighbors who live next door, the condominium owners, to be upset about it. That's all I caution you on.
I think we have to apply for that, too, because that's not something we own.
I think our intention is to see how it goes. If we have some interest in the community coming in to check it out, then maybe in the spring we'll apply to bring it outdoors. And even at that point.
I also caution you, be careful about, I think it has been done, to have amplified music, and then they open the windows, and then the music seems to go out the windows a lot easier.
Right.
Because it's amplified out through the windows.
Sure.
Again, just be cautious of your neighbors, all right?
Rick?
Yeah, I have strong reservations about the slightly amplified part. It's like partly pregnant. You either are or you're not.
Okay.
And slightly amplified, the volume knob has a way of going up, and I've been in there many times. I completely agree with you. It's going to be a small function anyways, because as you just said, you don't have any space.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't see a need for amplification. As Mr. Danahy said, when the windows are up, even in the wintertime, sometimes the windows might get up because it gets crowded and so on and so forth. So I'm all in favor of everything about this. I think I can understand the need for having entertainment. I like the idea you're moving into it, but I'm just not in favor of amplification at all.
I toured as a songwriter for 6-7 years. There's certain systems that we would never use. The intent of having a songwriter isn't to blow people's eardrums out. It's also not to be served as background music for a bar crowd.
Yep.
Our intention is to invite people to come listen to a songwriter as more of a entertainment piece rather than a background music. I don't know if I'm making any sense with this.
I completely agree with you, and I think that model is excellent, and we're going to have to agree to disagree on whether you need to be slightly amplified on that. I agree with the model. That's exactly what would be most appropriate there as a business model in sense. I completely agree with that. I don't think you need any amplification at this point.
I ran a songwriter night in a restaurant in Hyde Park, right on the Milton line, where I recently moved from. And it was a pretty successful run until the restaurant unfortunately went in another direction and had to end up closing down. But we had like I said, a songwriter night upstairs. I probably had the level on a 2.
Mm-hmm.
We had, I would do like an in the round type of thing where it was 3 songwriters with each with an acoustic guitar and a microphone. And when you have just acoustics, it's a totally different sound.
Mm-hmm.
So having a slight amplification helps with just absorbing the music.
Yep.
I think it, if the board votes amplifications, and I don't know how they're going to vote, but if the board does vote amplification, slight amplification, I mean, it's to your benefit to be careful with it, because if it gets out of hand, it won't be out of hand long before people complain.
Sure.
Right.
You'll be back in here.
Of course.
Trying to get your license back, because we'll, so.
It's not something we're looking to do late night. I mean, like she said, we were going to start off with, once a month or every other month on a Sunday afternoon for brunch. So it's not something that, we're looking to bring bands in.
I agree. Yeah.
I think Rick brings a good point. I mean, we have to be consistent with what we did with the other establishments. The Inn was just here recently. I don't know if we let them amplify? And wasn't TK's?
We did.
We did let them use
amplification. And I believe the Mill Wharf has one as well.
Those weren't recent ones, but we did let them. Okay. I mean, the problem is your proximity to people that are living. You're probably closer than anybody, any other establishment to residents, but.
And noise has been an issue there, and we try to address it by removing people from the patio after a certain time. And, we work well with the condo association. Well, at least we try to. And you brought up a point about the windows, and, we shut the windows at certain hours, too, so.
Yeah.
I mean.
Sean?
I'll be in favor of helping any way I can. I know it's especially after Labor Day, it's tough to run a restaurant in this town. But like everyone has said before me, you have to really be very conscientious of your neighbors, because we'll be the first ones, second ones, they'll call. They'll call you first, mm-hmm. Then they'll call us, and then we're going to have to react. I mean, you're in a very tough spot, but I'll give you a chance.
John?
I'll support you on it, with the caveat that, sure. You're adults, you got a business, right. You're bringing something that's new and novel to make your business more successful, and under the guise that, just be careful, cautious of your neighbors.
Appreciate that,
so.
Thank you.
Just one question, Kim, so can I just confirm something, because, so the other ones we did say, like the dog watch, we did allow amplification? Okay. All right. Are there There you have it.
Motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant an indoor entertainment license to JKM Square, or just
SQ,
LLC, doing business as Riva Restaurant, 116 Front Street, slightly amplified acoustic music, one to two performers, Monday through Saturday, 4 p.m. to 10 p.m., and Sundays, 9 a.m. to 10 p.m.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the opportunity.
Agenda item number six. Dave Wall, Seawalls.
Good evening.
Good evening, Kevin.
David.
Dave?
David, Kevin.
As you know, we have a Seawall committee in town, and we thought it'd be a good idea to bring it to the board and tell you where we're at and what we've been doing on a couple of the projects. The project specifically that we want to talk about is the one at Cedar Point. We had submitted a report to the selectmen from the engineering review that we had recently had completed. We had some CPC money that we received last year, and we were planning on looking how we could improve that area because we get a lot of washover and a lot of damage from that. Originally, we were thinking we could do some sort of concrete wall and raise it up 2 to 4 feet in that area and protect that. We did some borings out there. We found out we've got a layer of peat of about 12 to 20 feet in some areas, so that peat kind of won't it won't hold up well. In order to avoid the peat, we'd have to drive piles and it'd be a huge wall and it'd be very cost prohibitive. So what we've come up is we've come up with an idea working with the engineering firm is to build a riprap wall in that area and raise the elevation 2 to 4 feet in that area. The existing elevation is 16 right now, where the parking lot's 10. We'd be looking to bring it up to about 18 to 20 feet to help protect the parking lot and the lighthouse itself and wrap that area around there. So that's what the committee's been meeting on, and that's kind of the way we're looking forward. And we want to present it to the board because it's a historic part of Scituate, and you know, we want to bring everybody involved in it.
Okay.
Just so I understand it, so we're talking about from the lighthouse to the first house on Rebecca?
Correct. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
So what we were looking at is we would use the CPC funds, which I believe we had 475, yep, and then any additional funds that we had to kind of raise that wall up and improve that whole area.
What would be the time frame? When are you looking to do?
If we have all our permitting done and everything, maybe the springtime.
Okay.
You know, the problem we'd run into is if we were trying it now in the winter, we'd just get killed with the waves.
Yep.
And go from there.
How much is it going to cost to do that?
Well, we won't know until we go out to bid. On the last page of that section that I gave you, we had the estimated cost options. We would be looking at probably the bottom revetment type. This is page 7, which is around $576,640 is the engineer's estimate, plus the cost for permitting and everything else would probably put us somewhere around $6,625, I'm guessing, total cost project. The other options are doing the concrete seawall and a steel sheeting cap, which are up to 1.7, 2.5 in that area.
Kevin, sorry.
Go ahead.
Kevin, what determines how high you build it? Sea level's not going down.
No, sea level's not going down. We could build it higher and higher and higher. It's just how much money we want to spend on the area. As I said on page 7, you can kind of see the breakdown, but we went from where the tide level is and,
yeah,
you know, where we could get, I don't want to say the most bang for our buck, but where we could do the most.
Because I'm just wondering, you know, if you've got it, if I'm reading this right, 18 feet from some datum up to some level, I mean, how much more is it if you go 19 feet? Is that another 50,000, or is that another 300,000?
We figured in our price range was between 18 to 20 feet.
Yeah. But if you added another foot onto whatever you've already...
We could, but
isn't most of the cost The bottom part, not the top part?
It's the bottom, but when we put our slope out, we go outside the limits of the original wall, and then we got to go for different permitting through Army Corps and everything else if we go further.
Gotcha, right, because the angle of repose.
The angle of repose, so we have to.
Goes out.
Yes.
I got you, thank you.
So that's why we kind of stuck in that.
You just answered it. Got it.
I mean, there's no question about the need of this project. I mean, all one has to do is go down there, not even a storm, a cloudy day, and that's coming over the walls. Anyone else on the board before we?
Yeah.
David? If not, David.
This whole project started with an application by the Scituate Historical Society to protect the lighthouse. And then DPW felt that it made sense to continue it across the whole parking area. I can tell you that between Hurricane Sandy and the following nor'easter, that two of the large boulders that protect the lighthouse tower were pulled away again. And they were pulled away in the December 2010 storm, and they were pulled away during either Sandy or the one that followed. So there's now, again, no protection in front of the tower. That's what's happening, and that's in part why this whole thing is being done. But the other part, of course, is giving some protection to the parking lot. I know there's going to be some concern on the part of the public when they drive into the parking lot and see a higher wall in there. They're going to possibly forget that they couldn't see over the present wall. But when you drive into that parking lot and look out through your car windshield, you cannot see the ocean because it's that high. So it's not going to block any view. But an additional 2 feet makes a huge difference out there. With the new seawall on Rebecca Road that was constructed 5 or 6 years ago, they increased the height 2 feet, and it's made a tremendous difference. So it doesn't sound like a whole lot, but two feet, in fact, is a huge improvement.
I don't think you need a vote for us on this.
No, we thought it'd be important to present to the board, to let you know where we are and what's been going on.
To see where it's going and to see that the thing is scheduled, I guess, hopefully for the spring. I think it's.
In the existing elevation is 10 on the parking lot, so in the existing top of the wall is 16. We'd be looking to bring it anywhere up from 18 to 20, depending on how much we could fit in. So it could be a 2 to 4 foot difference in height for that wall.
So if I understand this correctly, again, we don't need to be doing any bonding or anything. There's the money from these different pools that you pointed out here. We have the money available just to do this.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that was the bond, $500,000 of that was a bond that was issued November 4th.
Oh, yeah, right,
November
right.
7th.
Okay. Yep. All right.
Thank you for the presentation. If there's nothing else from the board, we certainly, I think, understand the problem and understand the need for the work and look forward to it being done.
Thank you. We just figured it was important to let everybody know what was going on there. And where
it's
we're
great.
Going.
Thank you.
Now, are you coming up with a list that has the next 10 projects on it, I assume?
Dave, I think Dave.
Dave wanted to do some discussions through the Coastal Coalition also incorporated with this. We just, the first part of this was we figured we'd show you where the Seawall Committee was and what we've been coming up with. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you. I submitted to the board a report from the Seawall Committee late last week, and you should have all received it, I believe. Can you come up here too, please? I'm a member of the Seawall Committee. Kevin is the chairman of the Seawall Committee. We have several other people, including Steve Berlo, Jim Bailey, two contractors, and Tim Kelly, who is a meteorologist from NECN that is on the Seawall Committee. I had a discussion this afternoon with Tim Kelly. I just wanted to get his thoughts on what he sees as the long-term problems that we're facing this winter. And obviously his comment was that nobody can very well predict weather events over a very long period of time. But the concern that he has, and I think other meteorologists as well, is that there's going to probably be a tendency for blocking in the North Atlantic, which will cause more storms to come up the coast. We saw what happened with Sandy, and that was essentially caused by that whole weather phenomenon. So we're not going to probably have the same kind of luck that we've had over the last couple of years. So I just want to go through the report quickly. I assume you've all had a chance to take a look at it. We have a lot of people here tonight, by the way, from the various beach associations, and also other members of the Seawall Committee. We've met mostly monthly on the Seawall Committee since it was put together by the Board of Selectmen a couple of years ago. We have met with Carlos Pena, who is Vice President of CLE Engineering. We met last June with Jamie Gilmore, who was the Chairman of the Capital Planning Committee. And we spent over 2 hours with him talking about future funding, and that's kind of what we want to talk about tonight. Jamie Gilmore brought up three interesting points. He said that the last budget cycle, the Capital Planning Committee did not support funding for last year because they did not have an evaluation plan that had been done by the town. They now have that in place, and he has a copy of that. He made the comment that everyone in town has a vested interest in the condition of the waterfront, obviously. He also encouraged us to do public outreach, and we've been doing that. We had a booth at Heritage Days with a new brochure that the Scituate Coastal Coalition had put out and met with the public. The funding status, as you probably remember, is this. There was no funding for seawalls in the annual town meeting for 2012. There was $500,000 for seawall repair work the year before. That's going toward the Turner Road, Oceanside Drive breach in the wall. That was a $500,000. If that cost exceeds $500,000, then the town will have some money from the override that was passed a few years ago. So there is enough funding to repair that wall. And that's being worked on right now. Hurricane Sandy, as everybody was aware, did not strike Scituate particularly hard, although there was some damage. When I talked to Kevin earlier this week, he indicated that maybe there was some unraveling of revetment on Third Cliff. I did mention what had happened at Scituate Lighthouse, and by the way, that's not going to be a particularly huge deal to get that stone reset at the lighthouse, but it is a concern. So, we are looking for, hopefully, some good input from the board tonight, not for a specific project, but an indication that the board will be willing to start funding again seawall projects. Maybe, Steve, if you could pass out the sheet. The sheet that you're receiving now lists the capital from.
Thank you.
Thanks. The town reports back to 1998 and took out from the capital plan the funding that had been appropriated each year starting in 1998. So you can see what the town has spent over the last 15 years. As you know, we have had meetings individually with each member of the Board of Selectmen since last July. And we had the feeling that in those discussions that the board was looking for a particular project rather than coming up with an amount of money. So in the packet, we have listed for you three potential projects that we feel would fit into what the town could afford over the next year. And this information comes from the CLE engineering report. First one is Turner Road. It's north of where the breach took place. The 2011 estimate to repair is $355,900. It's currently
Dave,
rated.
What page from your
three
report?
Page 3 of 6.
3 and 6?
No, three of six.
You're mixed up. Okay. Oh, yeah, there's two different ones. Thanks. Gotcha.
Got it?
Yep, thank okay. you.
In 2006, when the evaluation was done at that time, that particular section of wall was rated a C. It is now a D. And by the way, these three projects were picked only on two criteria, and that is the present condition, which they're all D, and a cost estimate from CLE Engineering of what we think the town might be able to afford this year. So the 2011 cost is $355,900. We then list out the infrastructure that is in that area of Turner Road, Oceanside Drive, the approximate number of houses, the assessed value of $135 million, the approximate annual tax that is paid on those properties, some of the basic infrastructure, and so on. The final point, of course, is that any extra flooding that takes place in the Sand Hills area also affects Cedar Point further south because it blocks the entrance and egress to that area. The second project that we listed as a possible repair is Surfside Road in North Scituate. In 2006, that structure, it's a revetment, not a seawall. That structure was rated C. It is now rated D. The 2011 cost estimate is $609,000. Some of our volunteers took the assessments in that area of the homes by streets, and that's listed there. Total assessed value of the town of Scituate is $96 million. The approximate tax that those homes pay, $1,100,000, almost $1,200,000. And then the basic infrastructure, the 14 hydrants, a pumping station, the tie gates, and so on. And the last one is at Egypt Beach. That one was rated C in 2006. It's now rated D. Cost estimate is $400,000 from 2011. There are approximately 60 homes in the area. This one is also a particular problem because when the seawall collapses, and it will at some point in time, the first thing that's going to be taken with the seawall is Seaside Road itself. So all three of these are in a degrading condition going from C to D. They all fit pretty much into what we think the town should be investing. Again, there are other projects that are also rated D, but a lot of them are more expensive. Then on the last page, we give you some points to think about. There are 17 structures in Scituate that are rated D at this time. It's possible that in any one storm, more than one of these would fail. When a structure fails, obviously, it causes a tremendous amount of flooding. A great example of that is the December 2010 storm after Christmas. When that Turner Road seawall broke, it caused more flooding than it should have for that type of a storm. Matter of fact, a lot of the homeowners told me in that area, well away from the seawall, by the way, that the amount of flooding that they had at their houses was almost equal to that of the 1978 storm, because it just allowed so much water to pour in. And everybody's very familiar with the fires and all that went along with that. The other thing that we want to point out is that any article or any inclusion of monies, for example, in the capital plan, it should be understood by the voters that even though these might be a recommended project, if there are other problems that arise in the meantime, the town needs to have some flexibility. So for example, let's say that we decided to fund the Egypt Beach one. If there was a failure at North Scituate, a total failure, obviously the town is going to have to address that first. So it's not set in such a way that the only thing that could be fixed by the town will be that particular project. Steve has some comments I think he wants to make about the concrete. And by the way, Steve, he probably won't want to tell you, but he is a concrete expert. We're very fortunate to have him on the Seawall Committee. He's got some comments to make about the
concrete. Steve Burlow, 183 Turner Road, and I'm a member of the Scituate Seawall Committee. And like Dave said, I'm involved with the concrete industry, so my getting into the committee was to kind of evaluate the condition of the seawalls. I have access to concrete laboratories, I sent samples out. But not only are we in jeopardy of the walls falling over, we have a lot of seawall in Scituate that is actually corroding from the inside out. I brought some samples of different areas of the seawall throughout Scituate, and if I could, I'd like to show them to you. Years ago, I think it was the day they, when they did the shotcrete, Dave.
Yeah, after the 78 storm.
This is the only piece because I didn't want to pull any on. You can see that piece, there's that thin dark section, that quarter of inch concrete, is the gunite that was done, and underneath that is some epoxy. Sorry. Underneath that skin is, in those bags, are the representative samples of the concrete that is under that quarter of inch of gunite. You can squeeze those, you will break them in half, you may even break the aggregate. And without getting into the chemistry, the concrete itself is failing. It's no longer concrete. I brought with me a test cylinder from a project that they test strength with in a compression machine. This is what the concrete should look like. This is about 6,000 PSI concrete. What you're holding wouldn't even go into a testing machine. It doesn't have enough strength. Nor could I get a piece this big off the seawall. When I pull a piece of stone out, the bond around that stone or the aggregate just crumbles. So the wall has served its life, and it's time to replace those. Quite a bit of the wall was eaten away. Once that concrete becomes exposed like this surface, the wave action and the impact will just break it apart. And that's what's happening. A lot of the abutters have patched the seawalls, but that's bagged concrete. It's not meant for the purpose. So cosmetically, it may look okay from the outside, but on the inside, it's in serious trouble. And some of these ratings do not reflect what's going on inside. So I just wanted to let the board know about the condition of the concrete.
Can you give me two lines about the chemistry? You said you didn't want to get into the chemistry.
Well, there's a phenomenon called aggregate alkali silica reactivity. It's ASR, they call it. Cement's got alkali in it. If you have reactive aggregate, the alkali, when you have salt, moisture, the bond between the cement paste and the aggregate will eventually break away. And that's what you see happening here.
Okay.
So have you shared any of this information with the DPW?
Yes, Kevin's aware of it. Kevin's built a lot of seawalls in his time. He's familiar with the ASR. I do have the laboratory reports, Mr. Murray, if you'd like to see them, that came back.
I believe you. I just wanted to know what's going on.
Yeah, W.R. Grace and Master Builders both did some tests on the material that I sent to them, and both of the reports came back that it's in trouble.
Yeah, I don't think anyone has any doubts. They have not had doubts for couple of years now. Maybe a few years ago people went aware how precarious and dangerous it was. But I think the last couple of years, through the work of David and other people, I think people are aware that the seawalls need help. And like so many things, it comes down to, we acknowledge that, now where does the money come from? We have talked, David's talked, we have all talked, we've talked to our representatives, our senator, we've talked to our congressmen, we've talked to our U.S. senators. And, you know, the same answer comes back to us. There's no money. Now, I don't know whether we're not trying hard enough. I don't know if we haven't, as a seawall community, along with many other seawall communities, do we have more strength than we're showing to the State House and to Congress? I don't know. You know, I think it's going to take a united effort on behalf of not only the coastal communities of Massachusetts, but if you extend that throughout the country, you've got a strong lobbying group. I don't know how that's done. It has to start somewhere, but that's where the big money is. We can put in $200,000 or capital plan $300,000. You know, talk about a Band-Aid. It's just Something has to be done, don't get me wrong. We have to use those Band-Aids. A Band-Aid, you know, no one likes the Band-Aid approach, but sometimes it's the only approach you have when you don't have $10 million sitting in your doorstep. So that's all I have to say.
Joe, can I just jump in? I don't look at it like a Band-Aid approach. I'd look at it like, you know, rebuilding a wall with today's technology, like Steve said, that's not a Band-Aid approach. It might be a Band-Aid approach as far as getting all the miles of seawall done, but at least what we do, you know, give up the idea of trying to patch them or anything with this, you know, with this in the core. But if you do rebuild, you know, not rebuild, replace a section, at least that's one area that we won't have to worry about. And that was going to be my question to Steve is, you know, this, some of these walls are, you know, 50 years old or something like that. I mean, they've done pretty good with the technology they had at the time. What would be the life expectancy of a wall if we just said, you know what, you have a blank check, let's see what you can, you know, what would be your life expectancy?
I think an engineer would be comfortable giving you 100 years.
Really?
on a mixed design, yeah.
Kevin has basically told, I don't know if Kevin is still here or not, but he has mentioned 70, 80, 90 years, something like that. Is that what you feel, Kevin?
Yeah, that's very reasonable. It depends on what's happening with the ocean. And the intensity of the storm, because the section of wall that's built was a B-rated wall, it was one of our better walls, and it was just that force that hit it and undermined the wall, caused it to fail. Concrete was solid, it just came with the impact of that storm. Ed.
Tony?
Yeah, I mean, Sean and I met with the group, you know, at the Beach Association. I know all of you met with them individually, and we're all supporting the initiative. You know, that's all we talk about with our congressmen and our representatives. You know, Cantwell's working hard on it. Lynch, although he's just joined us, that's what he talks about every time he comes here. And even when Warren and Brown came here, that's what we were talking to them about as well. So, you know, the whole board, as well as Trisha and everybody else, is behind trying to get this federal money to do something, because the budget of the town, even if you took the full budget and didn't have any employees, isn't enough to fix the seawalls. So I think what you've seen this board do in the last 2 or 3 years is we've taken override money and allocated it to the infrastructure. Now, it may sound like a drop in the bucket, but $400,000 to infrastructure is a huge amount of money, more than this town has ever put into it, except in an emergency basis. You know, most of the times we fix seawalls when FEMA matched the money. That's the only time we did it. You know, FEMA would give 75%, we'd put 25% in and do it when there was some sort of catastrophe. So the other thing, just at the last town meeting, we passed the capital stabilization fund that allow us to attack bigger projects. So it's definitely on the radar of all of us. It's definitely a priority, and we're taking these steps to get there. But, you know, at the meeting that we met with Dave and the rest of you, you know, you were asking for things that just are not doable within the structure of the town's budget. And it's, you know, I think what we've done is we've taken the resources that we can and we've put it in that direction, and we're certainly trying to attack the places that we can. But as Kevin just mentioned a second ago, you can't pick the wall that's going to be breached next, because it doesn't matter. You don't know where it's going to hit. You know, it broke a B-level wall in the last big storm. So, you know, it's really a guessing game. But we know the ones that are in disrepair, and we're trying to fix them. And you know, I think that's, we're doing as much as we can at this point in time.
John?
I may be in the minority of my fellow board members here. I do think what you're proposing of trying to come forward before us to suggest some repairs on walls that have been devalued from a C to a D are significant. Obviously, as I've met with you folks, I've mentioned their priorities in town. But I think you make a very strong argument that we as a town need to start approaching to deal with them. We've looked for other sources of funding, but the reality is we're not going to find it. It has to start here within the town, and it's a priority issue. And my position is, you know, after the wake of 2010, the storm, I just didn't realize the power and the impact that these storms have, moving to the town 12 years ago, and I think it was an eye-opener for many people who had moved to the town, people who hadn't been here for the no-name and people who hadn't been here in 1978. I think it's an issue that the board needs to address and the town needs to address. and it's going to create a lot of issues. There's going to be a lot of competing interest between whether or not we put money, capital towards this or towards that, and I think we do have to look for it in our budget. You may not be getting the $1.4 million, but I think you need to think about getting something to fix. And you're right, you know, it's a B-rated wall. The argument is it snapped a B-rated wall, could snap an A-rated wall. But by the same token, I think you have to take a look at this and say when you have walls that are being continuously downgraded that you've got to start somewhere to start trying to fix the ones, the public walls, in my opinion, that the town have to try to target that storm, that energy, when it hits a certain wall. It may be, trying to locate a needle in a haystack, but instead of not trying to do something, I think we have to. And, being a seaside community with walls, you do put forth an argument of it does protect a number of homes. And I think the board has to tackle that. I think the board has to take a look at it. It's going to have to make hard decisions, maybe against the town administrator's capital plan, maybe against the capital plan. I don't know. But I think, we have to look for it. We have. We've certainly allocated, and the town has allocated a certain amount of money going forward. I think the issue that you're raising, at least what I'm hearing, is it enough to try to deal with this daunting task of tremendous amount of monies that need to be paid to repair the walls? And I appreciate your opportunity to come here to say these are significant. And I certainly hope this doesn't happen in the next 6 to 8 months to year, because obviously you're going to be in a great position to say to us, told you so. These are walls that just snapped and told you about it, So I think that's the thought I have that I'm looking at it. And I think, I'll certainly look at it. Have you presented this to the capital plan, what you're proposing?
No. And we're still not clear as to what the process should be. What we're hoping will happen is that the Board of Selectmen will endorse the idea of putting into the capital plan a certain amount of money. And frankly, we understand the constraints of the finances. But even if the town put in somewhere between $300,000 and $400,000, plus taking out of that $400,000 override 50%, like the town has been doing, $300,000 in the capital plan and another $200,000 from the override, that gets you to $500,000. And if the town is lucky and nothing goes bad this winter, then you have another $300,000 plus the $200,000 next year. Now you're up over $1 million. You're at $1 million. Now you can do something significant. But we are absolutely convinced that the town needs to start funding somewhat conservatively, starting with this next town meeting.
I think, if I may, I don't want to certainly correct my good friend John, but I don't think I have heard anything from the board to indicate that we're not completely in agreement with what you've said here tonight. And I think to assume that some members of the board don't agree with you, I think is probably not a good assumption.
Well, I'm not saying
I'm not talking about you. I'm just saying that. I think we fully agree, that there's a problem, and I think we all agree that we want to fund, we have to fund it. It's not even a case of wanting to. It's we have to fund it. Now it's a degree, our job of being, representing the fiscal responsibilities of the town is to try to find a way to fund it at the right level, if there is a right level. And that's our big responsibility. I don't think anyone up here anyway, I've never heard anyone say that they don't want to fund it or we can't fund it. We'll do our best, I think. I think that's, we always have, and I think we will.
Yeah, if I can just piggyback, not we will, we are.
Yeah, yeah.
We have. We started this 2 years ago. So this isn't, it's not the number that you want it to be, but it's a number, and it's more number than it was in 2011. The town has taken the initiative to start this process. The only problem is, if you want to take $500,000 and put it into the seawall, well, you got to take it from somewhere, and where are you going to take it from? It's not like there's an abundance of money. It's going to be people. It's going to be teachers. It's going to be firefighters. It's going to be police officers. That's what the budget comes down to. $300,000 doesn't sound like a lot of money, but it's seven people. So, you know, you're not going to get it from cutting back on pencils and paper. You know, the budget is very top-heavy with people, and that's unless there's an alternative source of revenue coming into it, that's what it comes down to when you go through the budget. And we're the next item is to go on through the budget process. So I hear your pain. I agree with it. I just don't see an easy solution.
If you take a look at that seawall funding sheet, going back to 1998, the town has been able, actually in 1998 they came up with $1 million, combination of the stabilization fund and borrowing, but on average the town has been spending most years probably $400,000. So we're not talking $500,000. You've already got $200,000 from override. If it's the board's decision to split it 50-50 between seawalls and roads, you've already got $200,000. If you come up with another $300,000, now you're up to the $500,000. It's not as though we're looking for $500,000 right off the top. But you've got a lot of seawalls that are in very bad shape. The other thing that I'd like you to kind of remember. And Kevin has mentioned this a number of times in the seawall committee meetings. When FEMA comes in after a major storm and says, okay, well, we'll fix this and we'll fix that and we'll fix that, you have maybe 3 points here, here, and here, and there are problems in between those various points. FEMA's not fixing that. So you're ending up with a poor job is one way to put it, because this is patched, that's patched, that's patched. If the town had just a little bit more funding, they could fix everything all the way between all those points. And it's not a very cost-effective way. Unfortunately, the government doesn't work effectively. But if the town had some funding available, then, you know, it's more cost-effective. The other thing that I came across through one of our members was that in 2006, the Romney administration came up with a $5 million grant program specifically for seawalls. It was one of these deals that was matching, and it came out in September of 2006, a $5 million grant program. It was available to those towns that had the money in place. The town of Scituate, I don't know if they applied or did not apply, but it was one of these requirements that a town had to have some monies set aside. And immediately, it was almost like a shovel-ready type of project. Jim Cantwell has met with us many times, too, and he has said to us over and over and over again that it's important for the local towns, especially Marshfield, Scituate, to have some funding in place, because he senses that in the future, with some of this legislation, it will be a participation kind of grant setup. So it's not going to be just outright money coming into the town. So again, we're talking, in my mind anyway, the amount of money that makes sense is $300,000 in the capital plan.
I think David, your role tonight, and I think you've done it well as usual, was to reinforce the need for this money, you know, the need for this money to be put aside. I think our role is to do everything possible to reach that goal. We certainly can't sit here tonight and say, okay, we're going to bring it to $500,000. I don't think we can, unless someone knows where we're going to get it, you know. Just speaking for myself, from what I hear from the board, I think the board's on the same page. It's just
I have one question.
But go ahead.
What?
All right, I'm going to go.
No, go ahead, Dave.
Who is going to come up with a number to give to capital planning? Is it going to be the Board of Selectmen, or is it going to have to be the Seawall Committee?
Can I just interject?
Yep.
We have a process. We have a capital planning process. There's a rating system involved. Those requests are due November 28th. I recommend, according to the charter, operating and capital budget to the board. The board reviews that and votes it. It goes to the advisory committee. They review and vote it. It goes to the capital planning committee. They review and vote it. It goes to town meeting. They review and vote it. So all through that process, from when the board receives the budget, January 6th, through to town meeting, that number is theoretically in play. and any of those reviewing groups can change that number. But there is a capital planning process that's institutionalized in the town, and that starts with my recommended budget to the board in January, and from there, everything's in play up and through town meeting.
Okay, so Tricia, if I understand it correctly from what you're saying, then you would be the one that would make the initial recommendation?
The charter requires the town administrator to recommend an operating and capital budget to the board and advisory committee. That's in the town charter and then further codified in the town bylaws.
Rick Murray.
Yeah, listening to this conversation from my perspective, given my day job, so I study climate, and I study past climate and current climate and oceanographic changes. It's very interesting, I think, as every selectman here has said in each our own way, we all support the fact that we need to protect our town and the citizens and the property. And some people might say, well, gee, why are you protecting all those oceanfront homes? I live in the West End. Or other people might say, I understand it's not just the homes because you're also protecting Front Street and businesses. But all this is just nibbling about the margins. And it's important to understand, I think, that we are nibbling about the margins, but these are very important margins because this is where we live right now. But, you know, Boston Globe did a long story about this 6 months ago or a year ago, and I was quoted as saying, we're fighting a losing battle with the sea. I think it's equally important that people understand that. And in 50 years, it's going to look very, very different. And so we might be able to build a seawall that engineering-wise might last. And I completely believe, knowing what we know today about material science and engineering sciences, that we can build a wall that's going to last that long. But with increasing storm intensity and increasing storm frequency and increasing sea level, which is projected to rise faster in the eastern seaboard than other parts of the United States and so on and so forth. We are doing the best we can as a tiny little municipality in dealing with a humongous problem that we just don't have the resources to do. That doesn't mean we shouldn't. And so I enjoy this conversation. I support this conversation. It's an important conversation to have. As Joe said, you're doing a very effective job advocating and reminding us, as if we don't need reminding, but it's good to always be in our face, and that's good. But I think, as Tony said too, you know, you can take our entire annual budget for 1 year and not do anything else in this town, and it's still not going to solve the problem. The big solutions on these problems are going to come from the state and the feds. We've got structural problems in the way the whole country is set up in terms of coastal insurance programs. We've got structural problems in building codes. I don't mean structural building, but I mean organizational and structures problems and how building codes are set up. And the only way these issues are going to be resolved for our generation and for the next generation are way above what we can do here. And again, I don't say this by meaning we shouldn't be doing anything into seawalls, because I don't believe that at all. I think we should be putting a certain amount aside a year, as we're all talking, and we're basically just disagreeing on the number. We all agree with the model. We all agree with the need. But everybody's got to understand that even if we put $1 million in a year, we're still going to have flooding. We're still going to have seawalls collapsing. We are still going to have significant loss of value. So again, not to say we shouldn't do anything, but even if it's $1 million a year, it's still going to happen. So to really solve this problem, and maybe at the town level we could start doing something about this, but we need to start looking at where we're building, where we're allowing homes that get destroyed to be rebuilt. We should be looking at zoning issues. We should be looking at utility issues. And so on and so forth. So,
on that happy note.
Yeah, I don't think we have any disagreement here other than the dollar value, but I just want to remind people of the reality, the fact that this is not a solvable problem in the next 5 years.
David?
I guess I'll just make one more comment.
Go ahead.
In our mind, anyway, $300,000 in the capital plan is a fairly conservative amount of money. We're not talking $500,000. We're not talking $1 million. $300,000. You're right, Rick, it's not going to do a whole lot, but you take the 300, again, you take the 300 plus the 200 from the override line, the other 200 goes to Seawalls, that gives you roughly a half million dollars. You can at least make a start.
I agree.
We're going backwards now.
Yep.
Yep.
No, I understand that.
Okay. Would you like us to come in every week from now on? We're willing to do it.
Much as the thought excites us.
I think David pretty well covered everything. I don't want to shut anybody off. If anybody has a comment, free to make it, if we could just keep it down to a comment.
My name is William Graham. I live down in the Glades, and I'd just like to comment about the safety part of the Seawalls. We've talked about the financial end of it and the infrastructure, but what about the lives that are involved? The Seawalls protect the lives during the evacuation process. We lost two people in the blizzard of 78. We almost lost a third, which was my daughter. And the town needs to step up and secure the walls the best way we can. Even though the tides are rising, we need to protect the walls so that we don't have loss of life in the future.
I think we all agree with that.
Yep.
All right, last question. Rosemary.
Rosemary Dolby, it's not a question.
The last comment.
The town administrator says that she starts to think about the capital plan in January. Can you give me a sense, all of us, a sense that perhaps you would encourage the town administrator to think about the $300,000 starting in 2 months?
I didn't, just a correction. The capital budget process starts next week. It's done before the operating budget. And there's a rating process embedded in the capital planning process.
I understand
process.
That. Would you consider...
I myself would not want to put any board member in a position right now after just digesting this to come out and make a statement like that. I think the board members, each on their own, can contact the town administrator with their views in the next couple of days or next week. So, but I hear what you're saying. Kevin, last comment, Kevin.
I just have one closing comment. The DPW is aware of some of the difference going on with some of the concrete and everything else, and also the stonework. Any additional funds that we have in the future left over from these other projects, we're starting to prepare a bid package now to go up to maintenance for the different stone sections of the wall, like, for example, Third Cliff, where we can go and address it. Some of the areas that weren't covered by the FEMA project, we use those funds to do that. So. We're trying to be proactive and go after the bad areas where it's going to unravel more and more. So it's a hodgepodge of where we're going at.
Thank you.
Joe, can I say one very quick thing?
Absolutely.
You know, I think we talk about the capital plan as being possibly the solution for this, but it's not really a capital issue because you want $300,000 every year. It's not like we want to go take $300,000, buy something and amortize it over 20 years and feel like, hey, you want $300,000 going into this budget every year. So there's $500,000 going into it every year. So, you know, although we call it capital because it's a capital project, it's really not a capital. It's not like we're buying a fire truck and amortizing it over 20 years. You know, it's you're looking to amortize a $50 million project over 20 years, not $300,000. And that's where it gets really tricky there, and it's not.
Well, we're looking for roughly, maybe it would be nice to have a little bit more, but I think $300,000 is a reasonable place to start for this year.
That's what you think.
So,
yeah.
But
yeah.
Who knows what we'll, you know, next year might.
Right, but if it was a $300,000 one-time hit, that's a capital plan. You're looking for $300,000 from now until it gets repaired, which is really infinite because by the time you get them all repaired, you're going to have to fix the ones you start at the beginning again. So it's not as easy saying let's...
But you have to start somewhere.
And we have.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next item is going to be the room's clearing. Al's attending another meeting on the easement for the landfill, so...
Mr. Chair, do you want to... I was the one that sort of... You want to do this? I mean, I'm comfortable making the motion.
With on the...
On the easement for the solar array?
It's up to the board. Do you think
think I have to hear any discussion.
Yeah, because the issue was I asked Al.
Is he coming back?
He'll come back. Yeah, he said he'd come back. I'm just going to move this around till he gets
but
here.
But he's coming back for executive session anyway. So
oh, all right, fine.
Do this now or whatever and move it along. It's up to the board's pleasure.
Can I answer any of Al's questions for this?
just, why don't we do it?
Yeah.
Sure, because I was the guy that raised the issue, and it's been answered to me, so.
It has. All right. Is there any questions on this issue, on this item?
Other than this is a continuation from earlier, I forgot, from October 30th. So we vetted it fairly well there, and we can answer it now.
Motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant an easement to National Grid for the purpose of installing and maintaining electrical connection equipment at 280 Driftway, Scituate.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. On this whole project, we've been asking Al to give us updates on it, the whole solar field project, and he's not here right now, but I'm going to ask him again to give us an up-to-date report on where the whole project is. All right, motion been made and seconded. Discussion from the floor. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin.
Next.
Thanks, Kev.
Kevin, thank you. Discussion vote, amend policy and contractual limits, town administrator authority. I think we discussed this.
I remember this.
Did we last week or the meeting before?
Yeah. Now, didn't we discuss giving that authority, but we get a list of, you know, we'd see what was coming up, and so we wouldn't, is it in there?
Yep.
You're good. I'll read it if you'd like. Make a motion?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to amend operational policy 29-98, voted in June of 2006, by replacing the amount of $25,000 with $50,000, and to amend the policy by adding the following two sentences. The town administrator shall inform the board of all contracts approved by the town administrator in excess of $25,000. Should a vacancy occur in the position of the town administrator, the threshold for contracts for goods and services, equipment, engineering, or construction will immediately revert to $25,000.
Did you second it, Sean?
Yes.
Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That also is unanimous. Budget, timetable, and schedule. Town administrator.
This is the fourth year the board will vote the budget timetable. It had to be redone this year because we passed the general bylaw change about it having to be published in the newspaper 30 days in advance. So the timetable always backs up from the day we have to publish it in the paper, which obviously creates a tight timetable for everyone. So that was redone. It's been, the schedule's in agreement with the advisory committee and the capital planning committee, because as you know, once you receive the budget, everything rolls to the capital planning and the advisory committee after somebody comes before the board. So I need a motion to have the board vote that timetable, because that's what makes us hold people to the fire. The budget is always in a very, very tight schedule, and there's not a lot of wiggle room, so that's why the timetable is very important to be followed. And then just informationally, because I don't think the board has probably seen it for 3 or 4 years, is the budget instructions that all the departments, board, and committees receive, the instructions, the budget development process for goals and objectives. You'll note on the timetable, as we just discussed earlier, capital requests are due November 28th. Operating budgets are due to me December 14th. So I'm happy to answer any questions that folks might have.
So the town meeting is April 8th. So 3/8 is when the warrant has to be done by. And we just basically go backwards from that.
Yep.
Tricia, so this one here, uh-huh, this calendar, so the first column, those are the selectmen dates. Second column is advisory committee.
Yep.
Third column is cap planning.
Yep.
Okay. Is there any flexibility in moving one or two of the panels around within those dates?
I'm not sure I understand your question.
Like, I have to check my calendar, but if, for example, we wanted to move one of those from the February 19th to the February 5th. Hypothetically, could we switch one or two of those?
One of the department reviews,
yeah,
you mean? Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
As long as we have notice. I mean, the schedule...
I can let you know tomorrow.
The dates are more important than what you review at it.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, fine. Looks good.
I need a motion on this.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to adopt the fiscal year 2014 budget timetable and schedule.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
I really love having this calendar laid out so far in advance. Very helpful.
Appointments, Public Building Commission.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Carl Campagna to the Public Building Commission.
Second. I'm sorry, I'll withdraw my second.
I don't want you.
Sean said it. I just know Sean knows him, so I figured, you know.
I just woke up.
Just a minute before we vote, just to remind everybody that we have a meeting scheduled with the Public Buildings Commission on the 29th. Thursday the 29th, just to go over the role of the Public Building Commission in the whole process of the grand plan and everything. So it'll be held here at 7 o'clock. Okay, motion been made and seconded. Mr. Campagna, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Town Administrator.
As you know, Kathy Meeker, our library director for the past 23 years, is retiring on December 7th, and she was recognized at a town meeting. A couple of items I just wanted to review at the board's meeting that were discussed at town meeting for those who didn't attend. I really want to thank Kathy for the work she's done in the town. I've only worked with her 3.5 years, but she was a superior department head in all respects and a pleasure to work with. And I think our library is one of the best I've ever seen in terms of the communities I've served. We had a very talented group of applicants apply for her position. The chair of the library trustees, Mary Ellen Garziano, and the president of the Library Foundation, John Cron, I know I'm going to say his last name right. Chronopolis. I'm sorry, John, if you're watching. Anyway, they served on the search committee along with Tony Snee, who's the assistant library director, and I'm pleased to inform the board that Jesse Finney has been appointed as the library director. Jesse is the current Whitman library director. She's a Scituate resident, and she will start December 3rd and work with Kathy.
Good.
So Jesse will be the sixth department head that's been hired in the last 14 months due to retirements or poaching. But so we actually had to have a goal-setting review with 5 new department heads last week because they haven't done that in terms of the budget. And we're in the process for advertising for a conservation agent. I hope to have that position filled within the next 2 weeks, certainly, as soon as we can do a thorough vetting of candidates. The second item is the FY14 budget process, which we just voted, and your budget reviews begin January 8th.
Television.
Third item, the master plan update with the approval of the school feasibility study and the Gates structural analysis final report completed on the structural analysis. We received those bound copies in our office Friday, and it will be up on a PDF on the website. Is it up yet, Kim, or going up? So we'll have that on the website. It's the structural analysis of the full building, and then Durkee Brown, the architect, is waiting to share, I believe, the final programming to incorporate in some final report. As you know, both the Public Building Commission and the board gave feedback to them about town hall programming and gates. So they've done that, and they have to come back and share that and get input. So that piece, which is an addendum to the original structural, won't be done for a while, but the structural analysis of all of Gates has been completed. And so obviously with Gates in place, the school feasibility study in place, the third thing, the third leg, I guess, is to begin the public safety complex work for design and engineering at Route 3A and Man Hill Road. Both Chief Stewart and Chief Judge have provided me, I have Chief Stewart's already, a report on the building challenges and deficiencies of both the fire and public safety building right now in terms of providing public safety services in this 21st century. And also, the steering committee needs to be constituted and will have tours through this building and the public safety building so we can start educating folks about the rest of the facility's master plan. I think, obviously, with the opportunity to get into the queue for the MSBA, there was a lot of focus and information in the public about that particular aspect of the plan. Now we really need to let folks in town know about the other needs we have as far as our facilities. And I'm happy to answer any questions about that.
I just have one comment, that maybe a question, as far as the school building committee that has to be formed. That there's certain guidelines that have to be followed, I believe, in forming.
Right.
Have we done, has the town done anything on this yet?
The school committee.
The MSBA.
The MSBA.
So we went through this process with the Wampatuck School when we received the funding for that. Because when the MSA went away and got completely revamped with the new guidelines of the MSBA actually dictates how the school building committee will be constituted. And that is in CMR, in state law, as to how it will be done. And it specifies who's on the committee.
But we haven't done anything yet.
We haven't done anything with that because the next step, and that will be handled obviously by Superintendent McCarthy on behalf of the school committee, to engage the consultant for the feasibility study. And that's when the school building committee will also be constituted.
Okay. Thank you. I didn't mean to interrupt, but I just
get
clarification.
The last thing is, again, I know, Mr. Chairman, you spoke about this at town meeting, about the town's increase in the bond rating. But one thing that I would be remiss is this was a project that we've been working on for 3 years. Clearly, since I walked through the door, I identified it as a priority. And the budget documents, the revenue forecasting, the timetable, the financial policies, that wasn't done in a vacuum without the treasurer, collector, and the accountant. And since the two people who did that work with me the last 3 years, Mary Gallagher and Jane Lopato, are no longer here, I just wanted to have noted in the minutes that they played a big role in that as well, particularly Mary, since we pretty much drove her crazy the first 2 years, creating all the forms that you're used to seeing now, but didn't even exist, 4 years ago. So
Rick,
I just wanted to note
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I just actually have a comment to the press and Ruth. I haven't, this bond rating issue is something that's definitely non-sexy, but this saves the town hundreds of thousands of dollars, and I hope we can get some.
It's already done.
That's our Ruth.
Thank you. I mean, because, it really sounds boring, but when it comes down to hundreds of thousands of dollars a year because of what the town administrator and her staff have done, it would be a great opportunity to our citizens to understand how much money Town Hall ends up saving.
Yeah, the chairman, it's a big deal.
It's a big deal.
Quote.
Great. Thank you, Ruth.
You said that town meeting, right?
Yeah.
Thanks, Ruth.
Yeah, and I just wanted the minutes to reflect the Mary and Jane's work since they're no longer here.
John.
Getting back to the master plan, Tricia, after you'd finished, I was thinking about this. I know that you said you've talked to both chiefs about what they would like to see and what they feel the flaws maybe currently as to what would be needed. What's the next step as far as the board we should be concerned about? Is there going to be a separate committee? Does it go to the Public Buildings Committee for beginning to think about preliminary plans for a public safety building? We've got it with the school. We've got it with Gates. This is the third key component, which I know you know, but I think, what are we going to be doing now? Because that's going to certainly need to kind of be pushed forward if we're looking for the annual of this next year or whether we're going to be looking for the following year.
Well, that goes, actually, that's the Public Building Commission's baby.
Okay.
Because it's, a town project without outside, and Kevin Kelly, our facilities director, serves, as sort of a a liaison to that committee, so he'll be shepherding that as well. As I suspect Chief Stewart will have a very ongoing and involved role in that.
Thank you.
Anything else, Tricia? All right, next item on the agenda is...
Other business?
Other business. Who wants to start? No one's shy, go ahead. Sean, anything?
No, not tonight.
Tony?
Sure, I'll mention a few things. First, a very good turnout at a special town meeting. I want to thank everyone that went and participated in town government. Would like to ask you, if you come next time, to stay to the end. But it was good to see people there, and good to get your voices heard. Quick sports update. First, I'll start with boys, girls, and soccer. Boys and girls soccer for the high school. They both made it to the playoffs. Unfortunately, their run was a little bit short, but they both had good playoff games. Football. We'll start with the little kids. The third grade and the seventh grade football teams made it to the Super Bowls this year. And the seventh grade team ended up beating Bridgewater, that beat them for the last 4 years in the Super Bowl. So they are the Super Bowl champions. To go along with the seventh grade competition cheerleaders that won first in their division as well. And more, most importantly, tomorrow, no, what's today? Thursday. Thanksgiving game against Hingham at 10 o'clock. So wear your blue stuff and go over to Hingham and let's watch that game. And lastly, holiday season's upon us. Shop locally. There's a bunch of different promotions and things going on. I know John can probably speak to it more than I, but I know that there's discounts available, but it helps the local merchants, and they have great fresh local products, and we'd like you to help support them.
John.
First Friday is December 7th down on Front Street for those people who are interested, and the merchants do a really great job in Front Street. I believe, Tony, correct me if I'm wrong, December 1st is Santa Stroll, is it not?
Is it the first? I think
it is,
yeah.
It's the first. It's the first Saturday. So in other words, for those people who aren't aware, obviously Santa comes vis-a-vis a nice boat and arrives at the Fisherman's Pier. And then parades, I think this year, back to Pier 44, is it, or are they doing it there?
It was last year. I don't know where it is. Is it at?
That would be Saturday, right. December 1st.
It is December 1st. But
say where they go, Rick?
Maybe.
No, it doesn't.
Raven, Saturday, you just look around. There'll be enough information out there, so be prepared for it.
On town pier.
That's it. Thank you.
Rick?
Nope.
Just one thing. I attended the Facts Coalition meeting last night at the library. Great group of people dealing with a very, very serious problem, drug and alcohol abuse among a younger population. They just do a fantastic job, and any way people can support them would be greatly appreciated, and the best way to support them would be to go to their meetings when they have them. It's just a great organization. John just reminded me, and I thank him for doing it, that Thursday is, as Tony referred to it, is Thanksgiving Day. We have so much to be thankful for, and the board wants to wish everyone, all residents of Scituate, a very, very happy, happy Thanksgiving. Enjoy the day. Next.
Minutes.
The minutes.
Minutes.
Approve the minutes of November 13th.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. I think that's it, right, Kevin? Do we have any other minutes?
Another set of minutes.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of February 28th, 2012.
Second.
All in favor?
I'll abstain on that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous?
Executive session?
Yes. Executive session. We'll be going. I haven't got my agenda.
I'm going to move the Board of Selectmen. Oh, sorry.
Right here.
Come and read it.
I'll move that the Board of Selectmen vote to enter executive session for the purpose of discussing strategy with respect to litigation. Because an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the litigation position of the public body. The topic to be discussed is the Glen. The board will not be returning to regular session this evening.
Second.
Thank you.
start to second that?
Actually, we will be, I think. Don't we have to come back for 14? Sign of documents? Or should we do that now? No?
Yeah, you do it now.
Do it now, okay. All right.
Roll call?
Yep, please.
Mr. Murray?
Yes.
Mr. Denny?
Yes.
Mr. Norton?
Yes.
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 Mr. Chairman, you have to declare that you've made a determination that if we did this in open session, it would be detrimental to our position.
If we did this in open session, it would be detrimental to our position.
That is the motion?
Yeah, I guess the chairman has to make it.
All right, thank you all for attending. We're going to go into executive session right now.